On January 2, 2015, the editor of website EarthFiles.com received a very unexpected letter from an alleged retired U.S. Navy Petty Officer First Class Flight Engineer. The letter received recounts experiences where the anonymous Navy officer, refers to himself as Brian, recounts his bizarre and extraordinary experiences flying cargo and rescue in Antarctica between the years 1983 to 1997. He claims that a collaboration between humans and aliens exists, and that the Antarctica is a major research ground for these incredible collaborations. Brian's high strangeness experiences flying cargo and rescue in Antarctica were in the 1983 to 1997 time period and included several observations of aerial silver disc starting around over the Transantarctic Mountains. He and his crew also saw a big hole in the ice only about 5 to 10 miles from the geographic South Pole, pink circle on map, that was supposed to be a no-fly zone. But during an emergency medevac situation, they entered the no-fly zone and saw what they were not supposed to see, an alleged entrance to a human and ET science research base created under the ice. Then at a camp near Marie Byrd Land, some dozen scientists disappeared for 2 weeks, and when they reappeared, Brian's flight crew got the assignment to pick them up. Brian says they would not talk and their faces looked scared. In this strange letter sent to Earth Files, the officer states that he experienced things such as silver disc starting around over the Transantarctic Mountains. During an emergency, they entered a no-fly zone and saw an entrance to a human and ET science research base under the ice. His crew picked up a dozen scientists who had disappeared for 2 weeks previous. They would not talk and their faces looked scared. He has decided to share what he experienced between those years in the following letter, reproduced in full next. 2, EarthFiles at EarthFiles.com. Subject, Antarctica UFO. Date, January 2, 2015. Hi Linda. I am a retired United States Navy LC-130 flight engineer that retired after 20 years of service in 1997. I have been wanting to write you for a long time about my experience on the Antarctic continent with flying vehicles that I was told not to talk about. I served part of my 20 years in the Navy with a squadron called Antarctic Development Squadron 6, or VXE-6 as it was also known. I served with this squadron from around 1983 till I retired March of 1997. Being a flight engineer and flying more than 4,000 hours in that capacity, I have seen things that most people have not even imagined on the continent of Antarctica. The land there seems more alien than earthly. Our deployments to this land started in late September and ended the end of February every year until the squadron was decommissioned in 1999. This time of year was the summer season when most of the science was done due to warmer temps and 24 hours of daylight. During my time in the squadron, I flew to almost every part of the Antarctic continent, including the South Pole, more than 300 times. McMurdo Station, which is 3.5 hours of flying time from the South Pole station, was the point of squadron operation during our yearly deployments. Between these two stations is a mountain range called the Transantarctics. With what we called severe clear weather from McMurdo to South Pole, the Transantarctics are visible from the altitudes which the aircraft flew, approximately 25,000 to 35,000 feet. On several flights to and from South Pole, our crew viewed air vehicles darting around the tops of Transantarctics almost exactly in the same spot every time we would fly by and view them. This is very unusual for air traffic down there due to the fact that the only aircraft flying on the continent were our squadron aircraft. Every aircraft knew where the other aircraft were due to flight schedules being followed. Another unique issue with South Pole Station is that our aircraft was not allowed to fly over a certain area designated 5 miles from the station. The reason stated because of an air sampling camp in that area. This did not make any sense to any of us on the crew, because on two different occasions we had to fly over this area. One time due to a medical evacuation of the Australian camp called Davis Camp. It was on the opposite side of the continent and we had to refuel at South Pole, and a direct course to this Davis camp was right over the air sampling station. The only thing we saw going over this camp was a very large hole going into the ice. You could fly one of our LC-130 into this thing. It was after this medevac mission we were briefed by some spooks, intelligence agents I presumed, from Washington DC and told not to speak of the area we overflew. The other time we got close to the air sampling camp we had navigation and electrical failures on the aircraft and was told to immediately depart the area and report to our squadron commanding officer when we returned to McMurdoch. Needless to say, our pilot, aircraft commander, got his butt chewed and our crew was not on the South Pole supply run for over a month. There were many other times we saw things that was out of the ordinary. One outlying camp, near Marie Bird Land, we dropped scientists and their equipment that was out of communication with McMurdoch for 2 weeks. Our crew flew back to the camp to find out if the scientists were okay. We found no one there and no sign of any foul play. The radio was working fine as we called McMurdoch to verify it working properly. We left the camp and flew back to McMurdoch as ordered by our CEO. A week later the scientists showed back up to their camp and called McMurdoch for someone to come pick them up. Our crew got the flight back there to pick them since we put them into that camp and we knew the terrain and location. None of the scientists would talk to any of the crew on the plane and to me they looked scared. As soon as we landed back at McMurdoch they, scientists, were put on another of our squadron aircraft and flown to Christchurch, New Zealand. We never heard about them again. Their equipment that we brought back from the camp was put in quarantine and shipped back to the United States, escorted by the same spooks that debriefed us about our flyover of the air sample camp/large hole in the ice. I could go on and on about things and situations that I observed during my tour with VXC-6. Talk among the flight crews was that there is a UFO base at South Pole, and some of the crew heard talk from some of the scientists working at the Pole of Ebbies working with and interacting with the scientists at that air sampling camp, large ice hole. Brian, now 59 years old, graduated from an Iowa college with an associate's degree in aviation maintenance technology and an aviation certificate. In 1977, he then enlisted in the U.S. Navy and served for 20 years until his retirement in 1997. He provided Earth Files his DD-214 documents and other certificates of service, including this Antarctic Service Medal given to him on November 20, 1984 as proof of his time in service. There appears to be many secrets hidden in the Antarctica, and we are pretty much hearing different stories every month about military personnel disclosing information about aliens in that part of the world. But what a great secluded part of the world for the aliens to keep out of sight from prying eyes. Or so they thought.